Well, good evening, or good afternoon, or whenever it is you're watching us. This is Corner Conversations, and as you know, we love to talk about literature. And Paul, what would you like to say?
Well, first thing I'd like to know is who you are.
Oh, I'm Roger Urban.
Oh, how urbane.
That's close.
Well, I brought two books today. And the first one is Hetty, which is a Hetty on camera four. There we go. This is a biography of Hetty Green, America's first female tycoon. There have actually been a number of biographies written of her, including The Day They Shook the Plum Tree. My mother and I both read that, and none of them are really sympathetic toward her. The thing that's commonly said about her is that her son had to have his leg amputated because she spent so much time looking for a free clinic. You know, and well, this book is much more sympathetic toward Hetty. And it explains that. Hetty was born in, oh, drat, I forget the name of the town, New Bedford, I believe. The family owned property in Buzzards Bay. And as a child, her father brought her to his office because she could read, and she was young. He and his father could not read the fine print in the business newspapers. So she read the business newspapers to them and learned the art of business watching them. And she was a debutante at one point. One of her aunts especially tried to make a young lady of her. And when she left her money in her will, she made sure that it was overseen by a man so that Hetty could not control that money herself. Well, of course, Hetty didn't like that. Hetty did what was unheard of at the time. She wanted to manage her own money. And once she inherited money from her father and from her grandfather, she began running her own business. Now, the thing about her son is that when he was 14 years old, he injured his leg in a sledding accident. And Hetty did not trust doctors. And at that time, it was not necessarily a stupid attitude to have. Doctors did not necessarily know a whole lot about medicine. So she fancied herself something of a nurse. And so she treated her son herself using a variety of home remedies. But when push came to shove, and she saw that he was beyond her help, then she did take him to a doctor. Well, by that point, gangrene had set in, and so his leg was amputated at the knee. One thing that came up in The Day They Shook the Plum Tree is, as a young man, she sends him to Texas, where he's running a railroad. And when her daughter, Sylvia, finally got married, she wrote him a letter concluding with, "Please come home, Mommy misses you." And the writer then says, "He had no choice." And, you know, I read that letter half a dozen times trying to find out what in that letter says, "You come home right now or you're dead." And there's nothing there. Well, the answer is in this book. His first job, had he bought a railroad that ran between New York City and Bellows Falls, Vermont, which is where her children were born. She gave him a job on that railroad as a Gandhi dancer. Are you familiar with the term, Gandhi mm-hmm. dancer? Okay, for those who are not familiar with it, a Gandhi dancer is someone who levels the track. Originally they used long handle shovels called Irish banjos that were made by the Gandhi Shovel Company of Chicago. And the Irish laborer would take the wide end of the shovel, when he could find it, jam Ooh. It in. This is just the way I heard it. Jam it in under a rail or a tie, climb out on the long handle, do a little jig step out there, and that'd lever the rail up and the tie up, and you jam bits of gravel underneath it and tamp it down, and that levels the roadbed. It keeps the train from falling off the tracks, which is a big drag for everybody. It's the lowest job in the railroads, lowest of the low. But when he'd been doing that for a while, she sent him to Chicago to look after her properties there. She owned acres and acres and acres of open land, which she rented to area farmers for a nominal fee. And so the land was being used. He was there to manage the properties. And she referred him to a hotel where she stayed when she was in Chicago, charged $2 a night. And so she gave him an allowance, weekly allowance, that would pay for his room and board and a little bit left over for pocket money. Well, he decided to one-up her. So he found a hotel that only charged $1 a night, which effectively doubled his pocket money. So now he could really go out and have a good time. When Hetty found out about it, she cut his allowance in half. Now, you can say that's because she was cheap and greedy, but it also demonstrates she was teaching him to work. You're not in Chicago to have a good time. You're in Chicago to take care of the properties. So concentrate on that. Eventually, she sent him to Texas, where he participated in two auctions, both for railroads that had gone bankrupt. One was a minor branch line that her business enemy, Huntington, needed to complete the Transcontinental Railroad. No one knew who this young man was who came to the auction, and to everyone's surprise, he outbid Huntington's agent. And when Huntington learned that was Hetty Green's son, he went to her office at the chemical bank in a rage, and he was gonna skin him alive and so on. She quietly opened a drawer in her desk, pulled out a gun someone had given her and put it on the desk. Until now, you have been dealing with Hetty Green, the businesswoman. Now you are dealing with Hetty Green, the mother. You will not touch a hair on that boy's head. And he left in such a rush, he forgot his hat and had to send someone back for it. And it took years of litigation for him to get her to sell him that railroad. And that's something else. Hetty loved litigation. The thing that my mother had heard was that she would hire a lawyer, refuse to pay him, and then she'd hire another lawyer to defend her, wouldn't pay him, get another lawyer. Well, I don't think that's true, but she loved being in court and she loved the game that was being played there. And of course, she loved yanking Huntington's chain. The other auction that he participated in was for a branch line that ran between, I believe it was Fort Worth, and I forget the name of the other town. And she told him, this is your business, you run it. Well, every time he had to make a decision, he sent his mother a telegram. What do I do about this? She never answered one, so finally he panicked, got in his private car, went back to New York, and, Mom, what do I do about these things? And she told him, this is your business. You run it. So he went back to Texas, began filling up his board of directors with people who understood the railroad business. He went out and got to know every one of his employees, from the engineers right down to the Gandhi dancers. And he built it up into a successful line, you know, branched out, going to other cities and so on. When he rode the train, he liked to ride in the engine where he ran the engine himself. And when his mother sent that fateful note saying, come home, mommy misses you, it's not that she was trying to strangle him with her apron strings. She was transferring him to the home office. And when you look at the jobs that she gave him, Gandhi dancing, learning to work, and work hard, sent him to Chicago to look after her properties, making sure that he kept his nose to the grindstone and his shoulder to the wheel. And finally to Texas, this is where he's really gonna learn business. He is either gonna make something of that railroad or run it into the ground. And he made something of it. So she brought him to the home office. It's really a remarkable book, and I highly endorse it to anyone. One of the interesting things in this is when she was living in New Jersey, she would give children in the neighborhood a bank. She'd hand out banks and put a dollar in each one. And a couple weeks later, if they could show her that they had more money in the bank, that is, they were saving it rather than spending it, she'd add another dollar. Does that sound like a miser to you?
Not really.
No, no.
Seems to me that in the past year and a half, I remember seeing a TV show about her. And I think it was dealing with self-made people.
Mm-hmm.
And they had not that story, but a similar one on how she actually made her money. And she was not unscrupulous. She was just good at what she did.
Yeah, absolutely. There was a church in Chicago that she had loaned them money at 1% interest. The going rate was 2%. And the minister wrote her a letter telling her, we are not going to pay off this loan. And if you foreclose on us, you're going to hell. And she sent him a letter back, pray for me, Reverend, because I'm foreclosing. And churches all over the country leaped to her defense. Ministers praised her from the pulpit. You know, if someone loans you money, you can't say, well, I shouldn't have to pay it because I'm a Christian. You know, right. If they make a living lending money, then you owe it to them to pay it back. And New York City went bankrupt, I think it was 1907, and Hetty saved the city by loaning them $1 million at 1% interest, 50% of the going interest rate.
It's not an unusual story, and yet it is. I mean, in those times, a woman having that much authority and power and business acumen, it's almost unheard of.
Yes.
And she was dealing with a bunch of, I would assume, competitors and folks who were really cutthroats.
Oh, yeah, absolutely.
So, and she was pretty good at it. Yeah. Pretty good.
The floor is yours, sir.
Well, thank you.
Well, not literally. I mean, the floor belongs to NBCTC.
Well,
I was speaking figuratively.
I will rent it for a short period of time at 1%. I'm just going to run through a couple of articles that I have, but I'm going to do one at a time if it's all right.
Mm-hmm.
It's from a magazine that I used to subscribe to quite regularly, and it was the American History series. Anyhow, when I went into the service, I had to quit subscribing to it because I was all over the world, and they don't send them all over the world.
Mm-hmm.
This is called a series of articles, and one of them is History Slighter Side, and it's Abraham Lincoln, the Inventor. It's by a lady named Peggy Robbins. United States patent number 6469, titled Buoying Vessels Over Shoals, granted on May 22nd, 1849, reads, to whom all it may concern, be it known that I, Abraham Lincoln, have invented a new and improved manner of combining adjustable buoyant air chambers with a steamboat or other vessel for the purpose of enabling them to pass over bars, meaning sandbars, or through shallow waters. And this is quite important because a great deal of navigation that Lincoln was familiar with that was down the Mississippi River.
Mm-hmm.
And being a large river and a meandering, what they call a meandering river, it had a tendency to build up sandbars in very treacherous places without notice. So getting a boat or a steamboat or a flat bottom boat that they used to haul materials.
Yeah, river boat.
Very important. You know. Lincoln today remains the only president of the United States ever to have been granted a patent. George Washington and Thomas Jefferson, and especially Jefferson, were inventors. Washington recorded in his diary the invention of a wine coaster. This was so called because a wine basket rested upon a roller which enabled it to easily coast along the tabletop and of several plows of a new design, one being a barrel plow, which sowed grain and covered it with earth in one operation. That's pretty interesting.
Yeah.
Jefferson invited a variety of useful articles, including the first scientifically designed plowshare, a three-legged folding stool, a folding buggy top, and a portable writing desk which could be folded for traveling, but neither man ever applied for a patent. Neither desired to make any profit from their inventions, more than that would be had for personal use. They wanted their inventions to be put to use. They didn't care if they got paid or not. Of course, both were rather wealthy. Jefferson went so far as to express doubt that invention should be a subject of property, and once declared that no gentleman should accept money for his inventions. With Lincoln, it was different. From the time as a youth that he made a flatboat trip down the Ohio and Mississippi rivers through New Orleans and experienced the difficulty of navigating on shoals, he wanted to figure out how boats could get across these things without running aground. When he thought he had solved the problem, he had hoped his invention would be a personal bonanza as well as an aid to river travel.
Now, was that Abraham Lincoln the president or his younger brother Abraham?
This was Abraham Lincoln the president.
I see that went right past him. Zip!
His younger brother Abraham.
Yes. Hi, I'm Abraham Lincoln. This is my brother Abraham. This is my other brother Abraham.
Uh-huh.
Oh, go ahead and hit me. You know you want to.
Anyhow, at that time, to obtain a patent, the applicant had to submit a model of the invention, along with drawings and specifications. The 40-year-old Lincoln, 40 years old at the time, whittled out a 20-inch long model of the adjustable buoyant attachments, which he had made, and he had no trouble getting the patent, but he couldn't market it. His invention was never constructed except in miniature, and that model can be seen today at the Smithsonian Institute. He failed to profit by it, according to this article, but didn't lessen his concern for the welfare of inventors. Kind of thing, and that's interesting. Lincoln, quite frankly, meant the chance to make money. Now, if this thing had come into being, and I'm not sure if it did or not, he could have made a great deal of money, because the Mississippi was one of the main channels of commerce from north to south, and this was prior to the Civil War.
Well, I'm reminded right away of Isaac Hodge, buried over in Hillside, who invented a railroad brake. It could operate the brakes on all the cars on the train from one central location. And after he invented it, he spent the rest of his life trying to market it. Every railroad he spoke to was very interested, as long as they didn't have to pay for it. And I get the impression that that might have been what kept it from being profitable for Lincoln. Here's this great system. Oh, yeah, we'd love to try that, as long as we don't have to pay for it. Yeah, if we're going to have to pay for it, well, we'll just make do with what we've got.
And I'm not sure that someone didn't try to do something similar, because commerce along the Mississippi continued up to and through the Civil War. And that was one of the Union's primary objectives, was to capture the Mississippi in order to cut, first of all, to cut the Confederacy in half, so to speak. Not quite, because a lot of the southern states were east of the Mississippi, not west of it. Texas was, of course, one of the differences. But the Mississippi was and still is very important to the commerce of the United States, and even more so in these days. And that is the article about Abraham Lincoln, inventor.
Cool.
The second article that I found, again, revolved around President Lincoln, and it was the plan to kidnap Lincoln that failed by one day. From 1855 to 1858, Thomas Nelson Conrad and Mountjoy Cloud, interesting name, Mountjoy Cloud, both Virginians, were roommates at Dickinson College at Carlisle, Pennsylvania, and members of the same fraternity, Phi Kappa Sigma, and close friends. After graduating, they taught in different areas of the country, but during the Civil War, they joined forces in the Confederate Secret Service. Captain Conrad was chaplain of the 3rd Virginia Cavalry, but his most important service to the Confederacy was as an espionage agent. In other words, he's a spy. He operated the only completely successful communication system between Washington and Richmond, and spent an enormous amount of time in the Union capital without being caught. His spy network was called the Doctor's Line. Medical men at that time could travel without suspicion, and many Southern sympathies and sympathizers passed along vital information. Conrad's most trusted associate was his friend Mountjoy Cloud, and I love that name, Mountjoy Cloud, whom he described as a bold and daring scout. The mission that they wanted to take on was to kidnap Lincoln and take him to Richmond with the expectation of negotiating an end to the war, and this was doomed to history's slighter side. They began considering the kidnapping when both were in winter quarters in the Chickahominy in 1863 to 64, and soon decided to plan it for some time after Lincoln began his customary warm weather trips from the capital to the soldiers' home. This was his Lincoln's summer residence on the city's northern outskirts. And you have to remember that Washington at that time was not a great place to live. It was built on a swamp. It had a nasty habit of developing clouds of mosquitoes.
Yeah.
There was no cure for malaria at the time. So it was kind of a nasty place. So during the...
I wonder why they chose such an awful site.
I have no idea.
National capital.
I never read anything that discussed that. But it is interesting. That's why it's often to this day referred to as the swamp.
Oh. Okay.
The president of the Confederacy, Jefferson Davis, didn't know anything about this plan to kidnap Lincoln. But the Secretary of War for the Confederacy did, and his name was James A. Seddon. He gave him orders to help them by directing Confederate officers to aid and facilitate the movements of the spies. And then Mountjoy, Cloud, and Thomas Nelson Conrad found themselves in Washington City. pardon me, where they enlisted the services of two other men, Bull Frisell, a huge, strong Washingtonian, and Conrad's slave, William. They expected the kidnapping to be easy, especially after determining that the president, ignoring the pleas of his advisors, regularly left the White House by carriage, unescorted, when he was driven to the soldiers' home. He didn't have an escort, save the driver. William, pistol in hand, would join the coachman and force him to follow Conrad on horseback, and Frisell, pistol drawn, would enter the carriage and courteously take the president prisoner, and Mountjoy would then bring up the rear. Now, that's an interesting place for Mountjoy to be. Mm-hmm. All would proceed speedily to the Eagle's Nest, the hiding place on the Potomac of Conrad's waiting boat, the Rebel Queen. Now, I'd like to know on the Potomac in the middle of the Civil War how you could hide a boat called the Rebel Queen, but I guess they did. Didn't say what shore it was on, so who knows. The day before Abduction Saturday, the four went to Lafayette Square and imagined their surprise and total collapse when they beheld a carriage of Mr. Lincoln moving out of the grounds of the White House, preceded and followed by a squad of cavalry. Conrad wrote, "Cabinet officials had decided to provide a military escort for Lincoln regardless of his objection. And after that day, it became standard procedure, and the Conrad Cloud plan had to be abandoned." But Conrad was always sure that if he acted one day sooner, he could have had Lincoln unarmed, unharmed, drinking tea with Jefferson Davis in Richmond. I doubt that would have happened, but it is a fate. I mean, it's a twist of fate that we don't think about. These things sometimes just come about.
You should read Sahara by Clive Cussler. I used to be
a
fan of Clive Cussler, but I kind of got tired of it. Dirk Pitt was too much like Superman, a raving sexist, and so on. But Sahara, are you familiar with?
Yes.
All right, then you know the big secret that's revealed toward the end is that Lincoln was kidnapped and put on this ironclad that's going across the Atlantic to Africa and then gets stranded in the desert.
I have the book. I haven't read it.
I've had me and my big mouth.
No, that's fine. I've had too many other books on my agenda to do that one. But he is an author that I enjoyed reading.
Mm-hmm.
And he's, like you said, his main character is a Superman, so to speak, not with strange powers, but the guy gets into ridiculous situations and always manages to get out with flying colors. But it's a good read, and it's an interesting read if you like adventure books.
Yeah, it is.
And he has a series. That is a series of books that Custer has written. Very prolific writer.
All right. My second book today is Who in Hell? A Guide to the Whole Damned Bunch. This is largely pure fun. Oh, look, I'm missing part of my hand. I'm missing my arm. Horrors. Oh, there I am. Okay, so this was written by Sean Kelly and Rosemary Rogers, authors of Saints Preserve Us, which I gather is about heaven. But this is a who's who of who's in hell. So, for instance, Pope Benedict the Ninth, who died and went to hell in 1056, his sin was lust. The boy Pope was all of 11 years old in 1032 when he assumed the chair of Peter. His exploits with the ladies suggest he reached puberty soon enough. One contemporary wrote of him he was a, quote, demon from hell in the guise of a priest, unquote. There were even rumors that he employed demonic aid in his relentless seductions. He was deposed twice by anti-popes and twice reclaimed the triple tiara. Then, in 1045, he took the uncharacteristically ethical step of resigning the papacy in order to marry his beautiful cousin. His severance pay consisted of 2,000 pounds in weight of gold, an entire year of the Peter's Pence collection from England.
Amazing.
Yeah. But the one that I find especially interesting.
11-year-old Pope.
Yeah.
That's new. I mean, I hadn't heard that before. That's interesting.
Oh, yeah. And then some of them got in by bribery, extortion, mm-hmm. and so on. But, great, I can't remember his name now. Utnapishtim, the name in the Epic of Gilgamesh for the Babylonian Noah, who actually precedes our Noah by millennia. Utnapishtim was the only righteous human and thus survived the flood. He now lives eternally among the dead, which doesn't seem especially fair. Drat. Now there's a particular name, and otherwise, this morning I could remember it. Origen. Origen was one of the early Greek fathers of the church. There, I've got him here. Origen died and went to hell in 254. His sin was heresy. By consensus of the greatest of the early Greek fathers of the church, Origen argued that hell is not necessarily eternal, that in God's mercy, everyone, even damned souls, even the devil himself, might someday repent and be saved. For these views, he was posthumously excommunicated and damned by the synods of Constantinople in 543, 553, and likewise declared anathema by synods in 680, 787, and 869.
They didn't like this guy.
No, and this calls to my mind a very interesting image. Here's Origen in heaven communing with God when suddenly an angelic messenger arrives, whispers in God's ear, and, Ari, I'm terribly sorry, but I'm going to have to boot you out of heaven. Oh, no, 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 it's my bad. When I let you in, I neglected to consult with the Vatican first. But hey, give my regards to Satan and the gang, won't you? Who did these people think they were that they get to decide who goes to hell and who goes to heaven?
Holds true today.
Yeah, well, you know, one of the things that I firmly believe is if the day of judgment, as it's described in the Revelation, actually happens, a lot of people are going to be very surprised. And the people who are going to be the most surprised are the ones who go into it believing they know how it's going to turn out. They know who's going to be saved and who's going to be damned.
Right. It brings to mind, and I don't know why we're talking about the Catholic Church in those days, but it brings to mind a show that I happened to tune into the other day, and it fascinated me. Here was a man quoting the Bible and saying that God says that if you sow your seed, you will be rewarded in multiplicities. In other words, you would get a lot more back. So I'm asking for, and this was, I was watching this about maybe about a year ago. I'm asking for your seed of $16. And I said, I wonder why 16 bucks? Why did he come up with that number? Okay, after a while I forgot about it. Saw him on TV again about a week ago. I said, I got to see this. I'm not knocking his Bible readings and his, you know, things of a religious nature, but now he's saying, if you send me $1,000 as your seed money, you will be amply rewarded.
Oh yeah, that's prosperity gospel.
He's amazing, this guy. And I'm not knocking religion, but I'm saying, you know, send him this $1,000. What in the heck is he going to do with it? Never mentions that.
Oh, well, I remember watching John Oliver doing a segment on prosperity gospel. And he shows a minister addressing his congregation. You know, I went and I bought a $5 million airplane, paid cash. The next week, I went and I bought another one that was $150 million, paid cash. Yeah, what? So he's telling them what they're doing with the money they give him. And they all think it's great because God wants them to be rich. You know, and you could buy Mount Hope Farm, you know, with that fabulous mansion with the built-in pipe organ and an indoor pool and a brass elevator. And you establish a church and you can call that the parsonage. And all that property is taken off the tax rolls.
Right. It's it blows my mind. When you come to think of what they are doing and realize that Jesus was a poor man.
Mm-hmm.
Jesus had nothing. And he's the, you know, Son of God, and asked for nothing as far as money. And these guys are, it blows me away. But to go from a lousy few dollars to all of a sudden $1,000, not knowing what you're going to get for it.
Well, of course, it starts small. You know, you send me what you can afford, and then as soon as he gets it, he sends you another letter saying, well, good for you, give me some more. And you send him more, and before long, he's asking for huge and huger amounts. In the movie The Name of the Rose, there is a debate going on in the church over whether or not Jesus owned the cloak that he wore. And this is a very important point because the Franciscans insist he did not. And their opponents, I forget who the opponents are, think he did. Because if he did, that justifies the church taking in all kinds of money and property and having it essentially owned and enjoyed by churchmen.
Mm-hmm. Now, trust me when I say this, I'm not knocking organized religion. I am not. I'm just saying I don't know how this guy gets away with it. I really don't. But I guess if you're a believer, you're a believer.
And, yeah.
You know, what can you do?
Yeah, exactly.
But if you send me your dollar, I will guarantee you at some time in the future, you'll get $2 back.
Yeah.
So, Paul, give it over.
Well, no. Having given me $1, you should give me $2 now. And then next week, give me $5. The next week, give me $10. Yeah.
Well,
so I have 2 more things to read here.
Okay.
Murrah, who was guilty of incest. There's no date of death given here. The beautiful daughter of King Cinyras of Cyprus, Murrah was smitten with lust for her own father and went incognita to his bed. She escaped his righteous wrath when she was transformed by the gods into a myrtle tree, whence the spice myrrh is derived. Myrrh was reputed among the ancients to be an aphrodisiac. Dante, in Canto 30 of the Inferno, has this pagan girl among the deeply damned for her sin of deception. But he does not include the lusty daughters of the holy Hebrew patriarchs Lot and Noah, who, scripture informs us, pulled exactly the same incestuous prank. Yeah, this book is based largely on Dante and Roman Catholic sensibilities or insensibilities, as the case may be. In fact, it inspired me to write my story, Final Judgment, where a young man, terminally depressed, buys a gun and a box of bullets, not really planning suicide at that point, but wanting to keep his options open, goes to a church, and an ancient priest brings him into his office, gives him a cup of coffee, listens to him, and, oh, well, it's a good thing you came to me, because if you kill yourself, you are guilty of not only of self-murder, but the sin of despair. And, oh, come on, how is despair a sin? You know, and that's something I really don't understand, because despair is something you feel. You don't deliberately decide, oh, I'm going to despair today. You know, so the priest tells him that the despair is the sin of refusing to trust in God. And as this lecture continues and becomes more and more of a lecture, our young man decides, okay, the hell with this. And if I'm going to go to hell anyway, I might as well get it over with. So he goes home, writes a suicide note apologizing to his family and friends for what his suicide is going to do to them, then writes another note apologizing to whoever has to clean up the mess, loads the gun, bang, and it hurts. It hurts like blazes, especially when the bullet goes out the other side, taking half his skull with it. But he's dead. instantly, dead before he hits the floor, and he's floating out there in the ether. And it's so peaceful. And then he finds himself gliding toward a light. And he starts seeing people. He sees his friend who died in a car wreck in high school. He sees his sister who died as a child. He sees his parents, his grandparents, and so on. And finally, he's in line waiting to talk to God. And who's in front of him but that old priest, who turns on the charm again and tells him there is no salvation after death, and all, well, I'll pray for you, but I don't know, blah, 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 blah. Yeah, okay, okay. And then it's their turn. Not the priest goes in and then the guy. They're drawn in together. And the priest seems to prostrate himself. They don't have physical bodies, but that's what it seems the priest is doing. And God tells him, you are not coming into my kingdom. And what? But I devoted my life to serving you. Well, that's appreciated, but take a look behind you. I sent you this soul, lost in despair, and you cited the letter of the law, but gave him none of its meaning. If that's the way you're going to serve me, I have no need of your service. Does this mean I'm not going to hell? Indeed it does. You were made in my image, but you and many others have been sadly misled as to what that means. The despair that you have felt is just a shadow of the despair that I have felt. So come into my kingdom, be healed, and I will show you other things that we share. And as he's drawn into the light, he hears the priest screaming as he's shut out.
Hmm.
And I love that because, you know, we're not necessarily in God's physical image, but a spiritual image. God is supposed to be a spirit. He doesn't have a physical image.
Right.
And who are human beings to decide who goes to heaven and who goes to hell?
We're going down a dangerous path, you and
yes,
I.
Yes, yes, I know.
However.
So here is the last bit I have to read, and this is off the back of the book. God, in his mercy, has ordained an afterlife of eternal fiery agony for many of his creatures, just to scare you back into the straight and narrow path. But it has been 5 centuries since Dante conducted a census of the Inferno and published his edifyingly vivid descriptions of the torments of the damned. Obviously, since 1500, the whole world has been going to hell. By now, Pandemonium's population must surely have exploded. But what new sinners are in? Who's hot and who's not? Just in time for the millennium, this encyclopedic directory of the denizens of the bottomless pit dares to name them all the fiends and frauds, demons and usurers, devils and fornicators, traitors, tyrants, serial killers, and habitual self-abusers. A fascinating, unholy horde who fully justify Mark Twain's observation, each place has its advantages, heaven for the climate and hell for society.
Mark Twain is another interesting person as far as religion goes.
Oh, yes. Now, we have just about 10 minutes.
Okay. I have one other thing I'd like to bring up, and I'm just going to read an article and let you think about it for a second. Everybody can think about it.
Well, you've shown it to me already,
yes,
so I've been thinking about it.
It all began in 1862 during the Civil War, when a Union Army captain, Robert Ellicom, was with his men near Harrison's Landing in Virginia. The Confederate Army was on the other side of this narrow strip of land, and during the night, Captain Ellicombe heard the moan of a soldier who lay mortally wounded on the field. He didn't know whether it was a Union soldier or a Confederate soldier, but the captain decided to risk his own life and bring the stricken man back for medical attention. Crawling on his stomach through the gunfire, the captain reached the stricken soldier and began pulling him towards the encampment. When the captain reached his own lines, he discovered it was actually a Confederate soldier and that he was dead. The captain lit a lantern, and suddenly he caught his breath and went numb with shock. In the dim light, he saw the face of the soldier. It was his own son. The boy had been studying music in the South when the war broke out, and without telling his father, he enlisted in the Confederate Army. The following morning, the heartbroken father asked permission of his superiors to give his son a full military burial despite his enemy status. His request was partially granted. The captain had asked if he could have a group of Army band members play a funeral dirge for his son at the funeral. That request was turned down since the soldier was a Confederate. But out of respect for the father, they did say they could give him one musician. The captain chose a bugler to play a series of musical notes he had found on a piece of paper in the pocket of the dead youth's uniform. This wish was granted. That music was a haunting bugle melody today we know as Taps, which is played at all military funerals. The story gives me a chill.
Yeah.
It really does. Guy goes out and he finds this mortally wounded soldier. The boy dies and he turns out to be his son. And in his pocket, he had written this few notes down. And now we use it as Taps. Taps is not only played at military funerals, it's also played at the close of the day.
Mm-hmm.
The words of Taps, if I can remember it,
Day is done, gone the sun.
Yeah, it's from my Boy Scout days,
mm-hmm.
Which weren't very long. but on my last ship, or my first ship, the Saratoga, we had, believe it or not, a communication system called the 1MC. It was a squawk box.
Mm-hmm.
And announcements would be made periodically over it. And they would play bugle sounds. We had chow, the bugle sound for chow,
mm-hmm.
Also for taps at every evening. So I became kind of used to hearing that every night. Reading this gave you kind of an unusual feeling about it, you know. But that was my story about Taps.
Yeah, hearing the soldier out in the field puts me in mind now I can't think of his name either. I'll do it without the name.
Okay.
He was a famous poet. Wrote Leaves of Grass.
Walt Whitman.
Yes, thank you. Walt Whitman. His brother, he was too old to enlist, but mm-hmm. his brother enlisted, turned up missing in action. So Whitman went down to the front lines and went through the camps looking for his brother. They were eventually reunited, but he also worked as a nurse in some of the division
right.
hospitals. And some of the stories that he writes about, there was one soldier, a Union soldier, who was left on the field after the battle, and some secessionists came along and threatened him, but did little else. And during the night, an older man, also from the South, went out on the field, found men who were alive, and took care of them. Found this guy, gave him a drink of water, asked him if he could eat some beef, and told him, I know you're uncomfortable lying in the position you are, but I'm not going to move you because it'll make your wound open again. You know, so just stay here. You know, and... Then there's another story. he writes about where an officer had, I think it was the top of his head blown off, and he lay there moving one leg. And by the time he was found in the morning, he had dug a hole large enough to put a rucksack in. And he died as soon as he was taken off the field.
It's amazing. this note kind of moved me a little bit. The song had always given me a little chill at night when you hear it.
Mm-hmm.
So that is the origin of Taps. But I, you know, you have to imagine this father finding his own son that he didn't even know was in the military on the opposite side, the enemy, mm-hmm. and the kid was dying or dead. And you have to wonder, you know. I don't know if this is true or not.
Well,
but it's a good story.
You might find this interesting. Go to the Williamstown Historical Museum, which is actually in South Williamstown now, and ask to look at the autobiography of Reverend William Stocking. Reverend Stocking was actually born in the Middle East. His parents were missionaries. And just across the road, his parents were from New York State. And just across the road, there was another family of American missionaries who were from a southern state. And I don't remember which one, let's say Georgia. And the kids were in and out of each other's houses all the time. It was like one big family. And when they went back to the U.S., they went, both went to their respective states. Reverend Stocking served in the Union Army. And after the war, he happened to be in Georgia and looked up that family. There was a happy reunion. And lo and behold, the sons in that family had joined the Confederate Army. And they were both in several battles at the same time. Never saw each other.
Mm-hmm.
But he also includes, in his chapter on the Civil War, an encounter with President Lincoln.
That period of time, the Civil War, has always fascinated me. There are so many good stories, interesting stories, frightening stories that have come out of it. How close we came to not having a country.
Yeah, we have 20 seconds remaining.
All right. We used our time rather well.
Yes,
please,
I think so.
Let us know what you think of our show.
Yes, and thank you for joining us this evening, or this afternoon, whenever. And we will see you next week. Thanks for watching.
So long. Not bad.
No, not bad at all.